If you have your Bibles, let's begin now. Let's go to 1 Samuel chapter 16. And I want to talk with you today about yesterday, today, tomorrow, and ask the question, where do you live? Yesterday, today, tomorrow, where do you live? And we will find it actually in 1 Samuel chapter 16. Saul has been rejected by God Almighty. So in the 16th chapter, now the Lord said to Samuel, how long will you grieve over Saul, since I have rejected him from being king over Israel? That is quite a statement. There are things God has rejected in our lives, and we grieve about it. Amen. Things God told us to leave it be, told us not to go there, told us not to have anything to do with that anymore, and we act as if we are being punished, and we act as if we would rather have a thing that God didn't like. That's a wake-up call. And so here God is addressing Samuel, and he's saying, you know, how long are you going to grieve over Saul? I have rejected him. I've rejected him, Saul. You're my man, and you're grieving over what I said let go. He says, fill your horn with oil and go, because I will send you to Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I have selected a king for myself among his sons. But Samuel said, how can I go? When Saul hears of it, he will kill me. And the Lord said, take a heifer with you and say, I've come to sacrifice to the Lord. You shall invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show you what you shall do. And you shall anoint for me the one whom I designate to you. So Samuel did what the Lord said and came to Bethlehem. And the elders of the city came trembling to meet him and said, do you come in peace? Obviously, Samuel had quite a reputation. Hello. We need to pay attention to a few prophets, church. He said, in peace I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Consecrate yourselves and come with me to the sacrifice. And he also consecrated Jesse and his sons and invited them to the sacrifice. When they entered, he looked at Eliab and thought, surely the Lord's anointing is before him. Now this is the first, this is the oldest son of Jesse. But the Lord said to Samuel, do not look at his appearance or at the height of his stature, because I have rejected him, for God sees not as man sees. For man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. Then Jesse called Abinadab and made him pass before Samuel, and he said, the Lord has not chosen this one either. Next Jesse made Shammah pass by, and he said, the Lord has not chosen this one either. Thus Jesse made seven of his sons pass before Samuel. But Samuel said to Jesse, the Lord has not chosen these. And Samuel said to Jesse, are these all of the children? Because remember, the Lord had told him to go to him and anoint somebody. And he said, there remains yet one youngest, and behold, he's tending the sheep. Then Samuel said to Jesse, send and bring him, for we will not sit down until he comes here. So he sent and brought him in. Now he was ruddy with beautiful eyes and a handsome appearance. And the Lord said, arise, anoint him, for this is he. Then Samuel took the oil, the horn of oil, anointed him in the midst of the brothers, and the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon David from that day forward. And Samuel arose and went to Ramah. Now the Spirit of the Lord departed from Saul, and an evil spirit from the Lord terrorized him. Now let's look at this. There are three men in this passage. You've got Samuel, you've got Saul, you've got David. I want us to look at them. You've got, and their attitude of their heart determined whether they were one of three kind of people. The attitude of their heart. Our heart is the issue, church. Not our talents, not our gifts, not all of them. No, our heart. So there are three kind of guys represented here. You've got a yesterday person. You've got a today person, and you've got a tomorrow person. So the attitude of the heart actually determined here whether you are once commissioned, whether you are presently commissioned, or whether you are ready to be commissioned. So we're talking about walking in the anointing of the Spirit of God. Now this is going to affect, there's not a person in this congregation that this will not affect today. Not a person. Not a person. So what is the anointing? One of the simplest definitions of the anointing is the activity of the Holy Spirit through a disciple of the Lord. And sometimes you don't even know he's doing it. Amen. You don't even know that when you least expect him, God just does things. So I could give you this definition that you could really hold on to. It's the conscious awareness that God is moving and doing what he could never achieve, in what you could never achieve in your own strength and in your own skill. That's the anointing of God. And we're talking about the anointing of the Spirit. That's what we're talking about here this morning. There are three types of people. Some of you may be a yesterday person here today. I'm going to explain to you what that means. Some of you are today people sitting around. And some of you are tomorrow people. And that, again, is what you have in 1 Samuel 16. Now, Saul was a yesterday person. He was wearing the crown, but he had lost the anointing. There are a lot of people who have all the, and were at one time called by God to fill in a certain place and do a certain job. But because of attitude of heart and things that took place, they may still be in that place, but the anointing is no longer there for them. 1 Samuel 16:1 says, "Now the Lord said to Samuel, how long will you grieve Saul since I have rejected him?" And I told you to go back and read, you know, particularly 1 Samuel 12 through 16. And you quickly see that Saul usurped the authority of the prophet and offered a sacrifice that he was not allowed to offer. Now you need to hear that. There are certain things you and I just cannot do. Amen. There are lines you cannot cross. Amen. No matter how wonderful you think you are. Amen. No matter how old you are, how young you are, because age has nothing to do with it. Nothing. No matter what you think you know, or no matter how close you are to the person that the real authority belongs to, there are lines you cannot cross. Amen. Amen. Now, disobedience didn't just quench the anointing that Saul had. It removed that anointing. And it was a one-time bam. There comes a place, there's some things that you can get away with, then there's some things that's it. And you and I have a tendency to think when it's it, the whole world knows it's it. That's not necessary. Saul continued to be king. He just had no anointing. And if you look at his life, he went through all kinds of stuff. God is a wonderful God, but when he says no, it's no. Now, so you got a yesterday man, and listen to this sentence. No longer useful or relevant to the Lord's purpose or of no value to the kingdom of God at this season. Now you better write that down because you go hear it over and over again. A yesterday's person, you're irrelevant. You are not of value to what God is doing now in his season and kingdom. That's pretty strong. I didn't say it. That's pretty strong. Oh, he looked good. He looked good. He wore the crown, but he was not anointed. That is a very scary and a very dangerous place to find yourself, my friend. Samuel the prophet was a today person. He was today. He knew the call of God. He knew that this was his hour. He heard the voice of God. He tried to do what God said, and he tried to carry out what God said without any hesitation. Even though he didn't like it, it upset him, it scared him, but he did it. Amen. That's a today person. Samuel operated in his anointing and therefore represents the today person. The today person is the person who is not living in the past, and he's not living in the future. He's living today. Are you listening to me? In fact, Samuel learned how to do that as a child. You remember when he said, "Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening," as a child? You remember all of that? So living according to the today person is a person living in the Spirit of God, letting God Almighty guide them and lead them. Could that be what Paul was thinking about when he wrote Romans 8, 13 through 14? If you are living according to the flesh, you must die to the flesh. But if by the Spirit you are putting to death the deeds of the flesh, you will live. For all who are being led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. I think we read that and just kind of go on. No, he was very specific. If you want to call yourself a son of God, this is what you must do.
Amen.
You have to live by the Spirit to be called the sons of God. Which would you rather have, a position and no anointing? Or an anointing without the crown, even if nobody recognizes it.
Amen.
You may have no mailing list, you may have no TV ministries or appearances, no big name, but in fact you have more power in the realm of the Spirit than a leader with natural human abilities, but they don't have the anointing. They've got the charisma, they've got the skills, they've got the upbringing, they've got the teaching, but the anointing is not there. Position is not what gives a person stature in the kingdom of God. You need to hear me. Position does not give you stature in the kingdom of God. Your title means nothing unless it's prophet, priest, or king appointed by God Almighty.
Amen.
And called to do certain things. Now, everybody operates as being a priest unto the Lord. But then there are those who have been pinpointed like an Aaron to do certain things at certain times and to carry out certain things at certain times. Maybe it gives you the ability, but it doesn't give you the right. This is one of the most beautiful afghans you will ever have in your life. We wanted to open it up so you could see the full dynamics of it. I want to remind you that this design that the Lord gave me in an open vision back years ago in North Carolina, and with a dove flying through the air with healing streamers, the scriptures on the healing streamers, it's just precious. I saw people loose their faith and turn it loose as they grabbed hold of this. We've already prayed over it with all from Israel. We've already anointed it with the oil, and we've already laid hands on it. So many people have. And we've had so many reports where people were able just to loose their faith as they grabbed hold of it. Plus, it's absolutely gorgeous. It's a product for this month. It's wonderful. You'd want many a person to have it. I keep it on my bed. It's beautiful. And guess what? It just puts you in the presence of God, and you wrap yourself in the Word of Almighty God. So in Saul's own eyes, he was a king. So despite knowing God's word, he did as he pleased. And it cost him the kingdom. Saul forgot that he served at the pleasure of the king, God Almighty.
Amen.
He was put in place by God himself. Excuse me. And he served God Almighty. Now, We're not talking about anything. Saul was only 40 years old when he lost the kingdom, church. Now, he went on to be king for a while, but he lost the kingdom. He lost it when he really, the anointing and everything moved from his life. Is there anything any sadder than somebody who thinks there's something when there is nothing? When somebody thinks they got something and they think there's somebody and they walked in the anointing and it's very obvious it's not there anymore. And all they can do is just act like they're somebody they used to be, but they're not anymore. Because the blessing of God is not on them anymore. There are a lot of people who fall in there. And a lot of us have been there and got out, and then God has forgiven us, and we've got past it. Don't sit there and look so holy. But today is a turnaround day. Today is a day to walk back and never go back there again day.
Amen.
You can be young and be a yesterday person. You can be old and be a tomorrow person. Now, tomorrow person is ultimately going to have a today. God did not use Moses until he was 80.
That's it. Amen.
Glory to God. Mm-hmm. Now, the first track to becoming a yesterday person is to put yourself above the authority of the Word and the lawful authority over you, to become impatient, jealous, arrogant, so that you take matters into your own hand and you move out ahead of God. That is very important that you hear that.
Yes.
You said, well, I'll never put myself above the Word of God. Every time you sin, you put yourself above the Word of God.
Yes.
Every time you and I commit sin, we have put ourselves above God's Word, because God said we don't have to sin.
Right.
So that's here for all of us. We're living in a time where people admire prestige and beauty and fame and power. But when somebody has lost the anointing and they don't realize it, how sad can it be? And it's even sadder when their followers don't know it either. What happened to discernment? You know, even Samuel almost messed up. You remember that in chapter 16? Remember when he went to check out Jesse's sons, when he saw the first one that looked so sharp? You remember that? And he thought, man, this is great. This has to be it. I mean, he's the oldest. He gets everything. He's good looking. He's everything else. So Samuel instantly went with the first one. But he was wrong. But you know what he did? He openly, in front of Jesse and everybody, instantly repented and said, I was wrong. There are very few people who know how to say, I'm sorry and I was wrong. I am sorry. But that is true. People know how to shake their head and walk away and say, oh, yeah, yeah. But there are very few who openly stand up and say, I made a mistake. Or stand up and say, you know what? You were right about that. I was wrong. Why? There's too much pride in the body of Christ. And pride will go before a fall. I can tell you, I've been there and I have fallen many times. Y'all look holy. I am with the right crowd, aren't I?
Yes.
Okay. If Samuel, who was an anointed, outstanding prophet, if he needed it in this hour in history, how much do you and I need?
Yes.
The anointing and to hear the voice of God. I mean, how do we need to know what God is saying instead of paying attention to somebody's cars and houses and appearances? I mean, the Lord talks about it in the New Testament. You go come and give somebody who's wearing a whole bunch of gold and doing this and looks sharp at the tack and give them the front row seat and put somebody else who doesn't look so hot back. The Lord addresses those things. Because he looks at the heart. I mean, you can dress up any old cow. But that doesn't mean when you take those clothes off, everything's okay. You understand that, and we got to hear it. God didn't remove Saul. Saul removed Saul. And everybody in here needs to hear it. If you get removed, you removed yourself. I'm going to say it again. If you get removed, you have removed yourself. You've removed yourself by your attitude, by the way you've lived, by the way you've acted, by how you've done, by how you've treated people, the attitude of the heart. You have walked outside of the boundaries. God didn't push you out. He had the crown, but it meant nothing. It was just a heavy piece of jewelry. Hallelujah. Because the anointing was there, no matter how heavy it is, honey, you got the anointing, it sits lightly upon your head.
Amen.
Saul had the crown, didn't have any meaning. David had the anointing. But get this. Remember, he had been anointing way back over there. David had the anointing, but he didn't have a crown for another 20 years. 20 years. Now I can see us now. How many of us who knew we had the anointing of God and yet the world had not recognized us would just sit back and go hide in a cave? No, we would be tooting our own tooter horn. Do you not remember when God anointed me? Do you not when he anointed and appointed me? Do you not remember? Don't say you wouldn't. We all lived there and been there. And then we end up saying things like, they won't let me. They won't let me have my place. Dear Lord, how many of you been there? I've been there. I've been there. I mean, how would you handle it? If you knew it, but you and God, but nobody else did. David didn't know it was going to take 20 years. God didn't tell him that. God leaves these little things out. And then every anointing is tested before it's activated. Why? Because you got to test the heart of the person who has it. Saul said to, God said to Samuel, how long will you grieve over Saul since I've rejected him from being king over Israel? Think about it. Samuel had anointed Saul king as direction of the Lord. He had high hopes for Saul. Samuel loved Saul. Yet the very prophet who had installed Saul as king, wow, was the same prophet who had to announce to him that the Lord had rejected him as king. That's heavy. And God wouldn't even let Samuel grieve.
Amen. Right.
Told him to quit grieving over it.
Amen.
Yesterday, today, tomorrow. Where do you live? You know, this is a pretty big challenge for us today. Because it's where we are. It's where the nation is. Where are you? Are you a yesterday person who just flows with what your whole family flow with it your whole life? Are you a yesterday person that all you can think about is everything that happened to you yesterday? What you lived through? What happened to you? What you went through? All your hardships? All the things that happened to you? We could sink a ship if we all could pour our yesterdays into a ship. We could bear it and hope it never comes up. We're not there. We don't live there anymore. That is not my address. We live today. And if the Lord should tarry, I'm still living for today. Because my tomorrow becomes my today. I'm living for today.
Amen.
To be of value today.
Yes,
not to let my opinions guide my life, but let the Word of God guide my life. Yes. I want to live so that I can be of value for God.
Yes.
Go left, but I want to go right. Go left.
Yes.
All we dream for, all God has ever promised, all the prophecies that's been given, they are spearheading
Amen.
To a point right here in front of us.
Amen.
An eye has not seen, an ear has not heard what our God has in store for us. It is an exciting, wonderful time
yes, Lord.
To go with God Almighty.
Yes, it is.
Hallelujah.
Yesterday, today, or tomorrow, three kinds of people. Look at yourself. Do you just live in yesterday? Which means you're not relevant today. Wow. Everyone needs to be relevant today, but you can't be if you're always thinking about, well, yesterday I did this in my past job, in my past marriage, in my past friendship. We have to live today. If you're not relevant today, you will not ever move in as a tomorrow person. These are the days. We are in the last days. Jesus is coming soon. You must put yesterday aside and stand as a today person in the calling and the anointing that God has placed upon your life, my friend. I love this thing that Pastor Kennedy said. We must be more concerned about our integrity than our reputation. Reputation is what other people think of you, but your integrity is who you really are.
This is one of the most beautiful afghans you will ever have in your life. We wanted to open it up so you could see the full dynamics of it. I want to remind you that this design that the Lord gave me in an open vision back years ago in North Carolina, and with a dove flying through the air with healing streamers, the scriptures with on the healing streamers, it's just precious. I saw people loose their faith and turn it loose as they grabbed hold of this. We've already prayed over it with oil from Israel. We've already anointed it with the oil, and we've already laid hands on it. So many people have. And we've had so many reports where people were able just to loose their faith as they grabbed hold of it. Plus, it's absolutely gorgeous. It's our product for this month. It's wonderful. You'd want many a person to have it. I keep it on my bed. It's beautiful. And guess what? It just puts you in the presence of God, and you wrap yourself in the Word of Almighty God.